Now, TJ Smith.
Knowledge, experience, and passion.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
So our very own Bill Vanko came in during a break and was telling me a story about a man many years ago, many, many years ago, was on the old Rash Field and was walking across the parking lot and walking across the field, and he saw a young man who was playing football by himself. The guy who was walking across, hey, throw that football over to me. And the kid tossed the football. He said, go deep. And the kid looked at him crazy. He said, go deeper. The kid kept looking at him crazy, like, what is this older guy going to do? And the guy threw the ball to him and threw a strike to him way down the field. And the kid had big eyes and said, wow. Well, that guy was the mayor of Baltimore at the time. And I have to say these words. He was a city college high school quarterback, and they won a lot while he was at the helm. But he's also not just a city college quarterback that won a lot. He was the last mayor elected more than two terms in Baltimore. He was elected three terms after serving as Baltimore City's state's attorney. Since then, he's been in higher ed, working at Howard University School of Law as the dean there. And since, he's been the president over at the University of Baltimore, and you all know who I'm talking about. I'm talking about former Mayor Kurt Schmoke. Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
TJ, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well. You know, I had to tell the story about you throwing that football across the field, pulling back your skills from the old city college.
Yeah, a legend in his own mind.
Well, thank you very much for joining me. And today, I wanted to have you on because July 1st was something that you proposed more than 30 years ago, and that was decriminalizing marijuana, certainly these small amounts. What are your thoughts, just off the top, what are your thoughts on the decriminalization that's finally happening here?
I'm glad to see that the most elected officials now, at least in Maryland, are talking about the drug problem writ large. They're talking about it more as a public health matter rather than a criminal justice matter. I mean, we know there are aspects of the problem that still relate to, criminal justice, gangs warring over distribution rights and things of that nature. But I'm just pleased that the approach seems to be, let's deal with addiction as a health problem first, and with respect to marijuana, move towards decriminalization in a slow and thoughtful manner. So, you know, I appreciate the fact that they, you know, went through a process of talking to the citizens and then creating an administration and then coming up with a law so that they're moving in the right direction, I believe.
Yeah, we're speaking with former Mayor of Baltimore, Kurt Schmoke, and current president of University of Baltimore. And you brought up the taxing aspect of this 30-plus years ago. But I want you to listen to this bite from you from 30-plus years ago with Ron Smith here on WBAL.
We would allow those people who are addicts and on hard drugs to register with our public health system and have public health professionals not only distribute the substances to them, but give them clean needles, which needles would be returned so that we wouldn't have the problem or reduce the problem of the spread of AIDS, which we now have because people sharing dirty needles.
So that was then.
Yeah.
If you look at the registering of people who are addicts, times have changed a bit. People think that we're watching them and all kinds of stuff. But do you still endorse that? Do you still think that this could be an idea? Because we aren't there yet. We have ways to prescribe people methadone. We have needle exchanges. But what about some of the other harder drugs? Do you still look at what you said then and say, we could still do something like that?
Well, I guess I still believe that our policy should be driven more by science than politics. And if we look at a couple other countries, particularly in Portugal, that they do allow a certain type of controlled distribution of substances when you're trying to maintain people and eventually get them off, but you're stepping them down from where the use that they're having now. I just think that some kind of medical intervention is better than what we have now. I mean, we've just gone through an opioid problem, and now fentanyl, mm-hmm. which is killing people all over the place. So clearly, criminal justice intervention by itself isn't solving this problem. So I would still favor looking at other public health interventions rather than just relying on locking up people to deal with the drug problem.
So with that, I sent you an article that producer Dave found. That's what kind of made me start thinking I should reach out to you for this conversation. Over the border in Canada, they have the same problem we have with the overdose epidemic when it comes to fentanyl and some of the opioids. And they have some lax or progressive drug laws, so to speak. And in reality, there's a guy who decided he was going to start selling out of a store under this pilot that they have going on up there, small amounts of opioids, cocaine, meth, and MDMA, and selling it. He's doing it illegally, although they're doing a pilot program of decriminalizing it. What are your thoughts on something like that? Should we have controlled spaces, which have been kind of known as the safe injection sites? But should we open that up to, you know what, if you're going to use cocaine or crack, use it here?
Well, I think we ought to do, TJ, I really do think that we ought to approach that the same way that the state approached the marijuana situation, which is go to the public. And let's have a good conversation where we can, you know, shed more light than heat on the subject.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to people about safe injection sites. Clearly let folks know that we're not trying to encourage drug use, but we're responding to the fact that there are thousands of people out there that are going to continue using these substances, and we don't want their problems to impact the rest of society. So the safe injection sites have been supported in some other countries, but clearly, you know, we've got a different political environment. So let's talk to the public about it. And you remember, for needle exchange, which now seems to be, you know, people kind of yawn about it because mm-hmm. there are 30 or 40 different cities that do it. But at the time, we
radical.
Were the leader, and people were talking about how radical, how harmful to society it would be, and yet it helped to reduce the spread of AIDS in Baltimore by having the needle exchange program. Now, so bottom line is I think it's worth having the conversation with the public, and hopefully we could get to the point not of letting somebody just do it illegally, but having a pilot program.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we did with needle exchange. We said, give us an opportunity for a 4-year program, and you can judge to see where it should go at the end of that 4 years. And remember that we got the approval by the legislature we won by one vote, and yet 4 years later, we got approval for an extension with only one person voting against it. So it does show how, you know, applied research, good science, working with the community can address the problem without it leading to all the horrible situations that people might think about if we moved in that direction.
We're speaking with former mayor of Baltimore, Kurt Schmoke, current University of Baltimore president. And in Canada, in this province in Canada where this gentleman's doing what he's doing, he's selling the drugs for roughly the same street price. Two questions for you. You spoke back in the 80s about decriminalizing to also take the value out of the drugs, which would in turn decrease violence.
Yeah.
How do we fight that and also the black market of drugs?
Right. Well, right now, what's happening is that the underground, criminal underground controls the price and the distribution. And when we increase law enforcement activity, they simply jack up the prices on the street, saying that their risks have gone up. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're business people. As I said many years ago, we've got people that are hooked on drug money as much as we have people hooked on drugs. So if you have a legal market out here that really brings down the cost, you just, in my view at least, won't have the same a level of violence of people competing for that high drug dollar. So, you know, that's again, dealing with it from an economic point mm-hmm. of view, it's how do you fight a monopoly? You bring in competition. And that's what I'm trying to say, is that we ought to end the monopoly on drug distribution that the criminal underground has.
Yeah. Do you think the state got it right here with this marijuana decriminalization or legalization, I should say?
I tell you, I think they're moving in the right direction. They're being cautious. And I think by looking at some other states and trying to learn from the mistakes of other states, that they are moving carefully in the right direction. But you know, because you're involved with police departments so long, you know that there's going to be some abuse. Somebody is going to make a mistake. Somebody is going to try to acquire a certain amount of marijuana and sell to somebody under 21. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know it. We're adults. We know that's going to happen. But I think that that's going to be the exception, not the rule, because the way in which the state has gone about it with this administration, at the cannabis administration that they set up, I think that that's moved the state in the right direction.